Oh man, I love PC game boxes. I can't get enough of them. I can't stop talking about them. So I'm not going to. In fact, we're going to talk about them right here, right now, in this video. This is the second video I've done in this series where we're just talking about the covers of big box PC games, the classic ones, and the large, awesome artwork on the front. Not talking about the stuff on the inside, we're not really talking about the gameplay either, just the artwork, the artists, and why they're so freaking awesome! So in the previous video, we took a look at Doom's box art, which is incredibly iconic, but it's also worth talking about Doom 2 on its own. For many reasons. Yeah, I saw this in a Kmart in I think 1995, and I was just mesmerized by this image. It looked so evil. Doom guy right there trying unsuccessfully to blow away a cyber demon. This awesome Doom logo with a 2 in front of it there that just makes it even look more awesome somehow. And just the ambiguity of the background there. Is he in hell? Is he on Earth? I don't know. This is hell on Earth. It's just great. I may as well show the European one as well. I like it so much, I have 2 of them. But yeah, this particular piece of cover art was composed by Gerald Brom. He's a gothic fantasy artist, and he does video games, tabletop games, novels, collector card games, and he's responsible for some of my other absolute favorite PC game boxes like Mage Slayer and Heretic, and Doom 2 sets such a precedent. Another one that I saw and just had to somehow get the game in my life was MechWarrior 2, and this box is really what did it. It's another one that I saw in the mid-90s and was like, oh man, this is like everything that I like. Fire, mechs, Pentiums. For me, it was really this box with the Mad Cat mech on the front that was like, it stuck in my mind, it burned in my mind for years and years and years, and like, it was 2010 or something, I went out and like started collecting all sorts of versions of MechWarrior 2 just because of this particular cover. It's nothing really amazing. In fact, it's just something put together using art from pre-rendered stuff by, as far as I can tell, graphics designer Jonathan Brown, who worked on the game. You know, so it's one of those intangible things about this. And here's one that I would say is just a very well-made box, minus any kind of nostalgia, because I never played this until recent years, and this is LucasArts' The Dig, one of their classic adventure games, and one of their uber cool boxes. And this one is one of their only ones that they had with this holofoil thing going on. I love holofoil boxes, the shiny and everything, but that's not why I think this is just a cool looking box. It's really just this huge lettering. All of this going on right here, it's full of so much mystery and action and intensity, and this is just the freaking box. This is one of the box covers for LucasArts that was done by William L. Eakin, or Bill Eakin, who also did their Fate of Atlantis, Rebel Assault 2 boxes, among several others, and also other games like Star Trek The Next Generation of Final Unity. He just did these really awesome paintings, and this one, while a little minimal, is, well, that's just one reason that I like it so much. I'm drawn straight to the center, and then it's like the title is exploding out of this hole in the ground that they dug up, I guess, because the title, like, you learn so much and yet nothing about the game just by the cover, and that's a brilliant cover. Another one that's absolutely brilliant without anything about the game being known at all, and this is a Gabriel Knight mystery, The Beast Within. So the second game in the Gabriel Knight series. That's one sexy cover. In fact, it looks like a, I don't even know what is that? A bedsheet, marble, 2% milk. There's like a werewolf coming out of it, and it's amazing. Seriously, this is well done. However, I can't figure out who actually put this together. I think it's possibly Nathan Gams. He was the art director of Sierra and, you know, did a lot of lead creative stuff on this game. So it may have been him, but there's no credit actually in the manual. Either way though, this is a box that as soon as I saw it, there's no way I wasn't gonna get this. If anything, just to have it on my shelf, because that, it's menacing, it's mysterious, it's different in tone from what you would expect from a game like this in a way, because it's a very dark game. This is a very bright cover. I like it. Here's a game that has been somewhat forgotten nowadays, but those of us who remember it, well, we remember it. This is Witchhaven. Oh, there's like lightning and maybe fire and all those friggin' skulls, and this dude is so evil looking. He's got a skull on his sword, his head is like, and his dragon wings or something back there. This just makes me want to play this game, regardless of if the game is any good. It is just an epic cover, and I hate to use that word, but you know what? This is done by one of those guys who just does, like, epic pieces of art. This is made by Ken Kelly. He did the cover for this, as well as tons of fantasy art for all sorts of different games and mediums, and also Witchhaven 2, but yeah, he's been doing stuff since the 70s. He's done a ton of other art, so if you like this kind of stuff, just really dark, gothic, evil-looking covers, just a classic style. Seek his work out. It is wonderful. Here's another one that I can't actually find the artist credit for. That's unfortunate because I think this is a very striking cover for a box, especially for this very memorable classic game. This is Sid Meier's Civilization. So you got this ambiguous cityscape skyline in the background here that, depending on the angle you look at the box even, it almost looks like it's popping out of the box. It has this really cool embossing going on that's kind of hard to get across in video, but it looks like almost like a paper or wooden cutout. And then below that, you've got the sarcophagus underneath. It's just like, yeah, you're building things on top of old empires and you just sort of bury it. And this is how it goes, because civilization, it's the history of the world as you make it. It is a straightforward cover for an insanely complex and wonderfully engaging game. I think this is just great, and I wish I knew who made it. Okay, we gotta get a little bit of cyberpunk up in here, because I just can't go too long without some cyberpunk. This is the wonderful Neuromancer, a cyberpunk role-playing adventure. This cover is by Daryl Anderson, who did many things involved with Neuromancer and other sci-fi type of stuff, but he also worked on the movie Johnny Mnemonic, doing like the effects and art direction and stuff. This brings to mind so many classic things out of cyberpunk and sci-fi from the 80s. Just this look and the whole glitched out sort of digitized nature of everything. This could be something by Philip K. Dick. This could be something involved with System Shock. This could be who knows what. This is dark, it's digital, it's cold. And that is very evocative of cyberpunk and the whole idea of this game itself. I think it's just a very fitting cover for a game of this style. Now, it's hard for me to decide on this next one. Do I like the first game or the second one better as far as the box cover? Well, I'm going to have to go with Diablo 2 here. Another one of those that captivated my attention in the stores and the shelf, and I'm like, oh, I want evil. Give me some rated M evil games. I didn't know anything about Diablo at that point. I hadn't played it. But yeah, this is my first Diablo game, and what a dark, gritty, grimy-looking cover. Flames and redness, and this is actually another one that is actually inspired by a work by Gerald Brom, once again, who did Doom 2, we talked about earlier. This is the original piece that this was based on, and I guess either Brom himself or somebody at Blizzard, whoever, ended up taking this and just sort of reinterpreting it for the cover of Diablo 2, which is fine. I mean, that's an awesome painting on its own, and then in a way, it just makes an even more awesome box. And next up here is a title that isn't necessarily a great game, but man, is this box cover just striking. These colors! Ugh, it's great. And so simple. This is ZPC, a game that's actually based on Bungie's Marathon engine, and it's a shooter, and, you know, like I said, it's not particularly the best thing ever, but it kind of reminds me of a little bit later on, like the Max Payne covers, you know, that sort of simple cutout blocky, looks very stenciled, and I like stencil art and pop art and different things that make use of similar styles to this, and there are very few game boxes that do that. Well, this is one of them that I have, at least, and I think it's great. It's aesthetically pleasing as balls. Not that balls are, but it's an expression that I say, whatever. I like this box. Another box that I am just drawn to so much, especially for the colors, but really just the entire composition of it being just a little bit different than anything else that I have on my shelf. This is the Bitmap Brothers game, Gods, and this is the PC version from Konami that was released in America. And I like this one because it has a larger version of the box art that you saw in other territories around the world. So this is actually a piece of art by Simon Bisley, who also did Terminator Rampage, the cover for that game, which is also an excellent cover. But he also is known for a whole lot of comic book stuff. Lots of great comic art, Judge Dredd series stuff, and heavy metal, and It did some stuff for FAQ 2. It's not all like this, but this is definitely reminiscent of some of his style around this time, right around the early 90s, late 80s and whatnot. It is so freaking chaotic. Why are there so many muscles and teeth and hair? And it's just, it's, what is this? This is the stupidest, most grotesque, over-the-top thing. And yet, all it says is there's going to be crazy friggin' monsters. And you're probably a dude with this, what the heck kind of head is that? And so many muscles. Perfect. I can't help it. I love the cover to Daikatana, or John Romero's Daikatana, as it were. Say what you want about the game. In fact, I will have things to say on it in the future whenever I do a review on this. But yeah, you got the fake, like, Japanese going on there, and I don't care if it's just mumbo jumbo and it doesn't actually mean anything. From what I've read, it doesn't mean anything. Maybe it does, I don't know, but it's simple. And it's striking. And it stood out on the shelf amongst so many other things. Even though bright red and black is a pretty common motif. Although I hate the fact that there's this stupid sticker on my copy. Thankfully, though, this is not the only copy that I have. Since I actually had a signed copy by John Romero sent to me by the man himself. Signed it right here. And this is an uncirculated box that has never, you know, been used or sold or even put together completely. Now, this cover was designed by none other than Sasha Shure, and she did all of Ion Storm's logos and box covers, as well as the incredibly iconic Quake logo, which I almost included in this one. You know, the Quake boxes are some of my favorites. Ah, screw it. Fine, here's just the Quake 2 I had on the shelf over there. Ah, man, there's something about this style. She definitely had a way with composition, and I'm a big fan. And last but not least is the progenitor of the survival horror series as we came to know it, and that is Alone in the Dark. And this is the North American release. The European one had a different cover, and I don't like it as much. This cover in particular, well, it was kind of hard to figure out who it was actually made by, because it's another one of those that's uncredited, and I have no idea why there's so many companies that just don't credit their freaking artists for their box. These are so, they become so iconic, and there's words burned in our head so often when we think of games. But anyway, this one was uncredited, and I figured out, thanks to some help from awesome people on Twitter, that this was actually painted by Bruce Eagle. And you can actually see over here in the bottom left corner his signature right there that just said Eagle. This was the only clue we had to go on, but eventually we tracked him down. Unfortunately, sounds like he passed away recently. He was a commission artist, did all sorts of things, freelance and professionally and just whatever else, working for Disney and then other companies. Other than Infogrames here, you also had him doing stuff for the Mindcraft company, doing covers for games like Magic Candle 3, Tegel's Mercenaries, and Siege, among several others. And this one in particular just evokes so much of the feeling of Alone in the Dark. I mean, this, to me, just, it makes so much sense. Even if the protagonist doesn't necessarily look exactly like that, the house is glowing green, there's like Satan coming out the top left over there, there's lightning, there's fog. This is a classic horror cover. Ah, it's good. And that's all for this entry in my Best PC Game Box Art series. I'm sure there's going to be more to come. I've got another dozen lined up already, and if you would like to see some of those, then you can subscribe, or you can just watch some of my other videos that are already here. My other one on Best PC Game Boxes, as well as my video on the worst PC Game Box covers. Those are clickable right here, and you can also just look on Twitter and Facebook if you'd like to interact with and follow me and help me find out some of these artists sometime, because I can't always do it alone. And you can also support the show on Patreon, which gets you some cool perks like seeing videos early and other stuff like that. And as always, thank you very much for watching.